Good afternoon, Barnes & Noble guests. Grab your beach towel and a passion tea lemonade for an afternoon of magic, mystery, and tropical romance. We are pleased to welcome Maryann Ridini Spencer, author of the new release, Lady in the Window, to our store. After the Q&A, we will move to the front of the store for photo ops and personal signings. Lady in the Window is an inspiring story with great insight into the human heart, a perfect remedy for the stresses we all experience, and as soothing as an ocean sunset. This is a story that will stay with you for a long time. Please help us welcome Maryann Ridini Spencer.
Hello, folks. Aloha and welcome, as they say in Hawaii. And aloha means hello and goodbye. And it also means with love and affection. And that's one of the things I love about Hawaii, the meaning of aloha. Because I had an inspiration to write a book. About 2013, I wanted to write a story that dealt with a spirit helping a living person. And at first I was going to place it on Long Island in a little town called Kutchog out in the Hampton area. That's where my parents lived, and it's just a beautiful little town on the water, and I thought, how perfect. But I started to change my idea of where I wanted. I started to do the outline. And then I decided, no, I think I'm going to place it in France during World War II. I had written a lot of stories and screenplays about France, The Lost Valentine, actually, which was a TV movie for Hallmark Hall of Fame, was based on a book by James Michael Pratt, and I found the book, and I produced it and co-wrote it. And I thought, you know, let me go to World War II. And then I said, no, I started writing it. I did a few chapters. I like it, but it wasn't this book. So I decided on a family vacation in 2014. We go to the islands all the time, Hawaii, and we even have a place on the Big Island. And the first time though, it was the first time I ever went to Kauai. And I just fell in love with it. And I think at the time, I was working very hard. And I probably was a little stressed, and when I got to Kauai, it was like, I could breathe. And one afternoon, my husband and son went surfing, and I said, okay, I'm gonna go shopping in Hanalei Town. And as I was walking down the streets, I just noticed I started, and I started humming and singing, and I was like, wait, whoa, that's not me, you know? I was really tight wound when I got there. And so I walked down to the water, and down this little road, Wakey Road, which led to the Hanalei Pier. And as I rounded the corner and I saw that beautiful Hanalei Bay, I thought, oh my God, I have to place the book here. And then I started rewriting the outline. And later that year in 2014, my dear mom passed away. And after that, the whole story unfolded for me because I drew from some of my own experiences, as most authors do, but I also incorporated other things that I felt would help people in terms of healing. Certain things that I went through as a young woman, dating, because this is definitely about a young girl who's trying to find her own way in the world in terms of personally and professionally. But it also deals with family, and it deals with relationships and love, and the core theme that our loved ones guide us, and after they pass, they are around us if we can know the signs and if we learn how to be open to the signs. And part of it for me and for Kate, my character, is to be in nature and to be open and to meditate and to really kind of let yourself experience what you are experiencing right in the moment. Not thinking too far ahead, not thinking about the past too much. And I felt, in Hawaii, I feel that, and definitely in Kauai at that point in time, I did. So I'm gonna read a little excerpt from the book that will kind of take you into the story, and it's the prologue. And then after that, we can do some Q&A. A balmy, gentle breeze rolls off the nearby azure ocean and makes its way through the towering palms lining Wiki Road. Studded with picturesque homes from simple beach cottages to lavish mansions, the street ends at Kauai's breathtakingly beautiful, otherworldly Hanalei Pier. Birds chirp in unison, breaking the morning stillness, as if to greet one another with a cheerful aloha. In the second floor window of a charming white cottage nestled in the heart of Winky Road stands the lady. She looks down at the street below, catching sight of a pretty 30-year-old Kate Grace, who is deep in thought as she walks in front of the home, pebbles crunching underneath her feet as she kicks a stone here and there with the rim of her sandals. The tropical breeze gingerly caresses Kate's shoulder-length auburn hair, and every so often she eyes the white cottage, an inviting plantation-style bungalow with a large roof lanai and a welcoming pathway of gray pavers that lead up to a pastel blue front door. The two lush plumeria trees that stand on each side of the front entryway, with their blooms of fragrant velvety white blossoms and sunburst yellow centers, seem to beckon her in. Suddenly, Kate stops pacing. Overcome with sadness, she breaks into deep, guttural sobs, quickly covering her mouth with one hand and her heart with the other, as if trying to repress the outpouring of emotions. Head in her hand, she collapses forward on the hood of her rented PT Cruiser. The lady in the window, her eyes wide now with wonder and concern, feels a sudden stab of empathetic pain for the girl, and she grabs a hold of her heart in the same fashion. The lady watches as Kate tears flow unrelenting, and with an urgent desire to ease this young woman's sorrow, as any mother would want to do for her own daughter, the lady moves her hand from over her heart and places it on the window pane. She spreads her fingers wide, and with a will powered by the divine, a sudden burst of compassionate energy flows from the depth of the lady's soul through the tips of her fingers and sears through the glass to the ground below, where it surrounds Kate like a loving pair of arms. Kate immediately feels an overwhelming sense of warmth and comfort, and as abruptly as they started, her tears stop. The pain dissipates. A light switch has turned from on to off. Puzzled by her change of mood, Kate stands still for a moment to relish the comforting sensation before wiping wet tears from her cheeks and taking in a few deep cleansing breaths. The respite doesn't last long, as Kate, realizing that her realtor will be pulling up any minute, she glances at her watch. She then digs deep into her large straw bag slung over her shoulder and pulls out a compact. And as she looks into the mirror to assess the damage and make the necessary repairs, she notices some movement. A darkened figure in the cottage window. Is someone home? Hello, hello, Kate yells, waving, walking onto the stone pathway. Excuse me, is anyone home? There's no one at home. She decides the sun must be playing tricks on her eyes. After all, the realtor told her the house had been empty for some time. She shakes her head, chuckling to herself, and then deposits the compact back in her bag. Leaning with her back against the PT Cruiser, she stares up at the vacant window. And as she does, she feels a curious, strange, warm, tingling sensation on her bare arms. And she hugs herself, reveling in the feeling. Her face, stained with tears just moments ago, is now bright with a smile. The lady looks down at Kate and smiles broadly in return. Several minutes later, Kate's realtor, Elaine Harrison, pulls up in her white Mercedes convertible. Aloha, Kate! Elaine, an attractive woman of 42, dressed in a smart floral pre-print set, embraces her with genuine affection. Mahalo for coming, replies Kate, using the Hawaiian word for thank you. But of course, darling, says Elaine. Originally from London, her sophisticated British lilt is evident from the lovely, gentle rising and falling of her voice. Come, let me show you the lay of the land. Kate's mouth drops open as she enters the cottage. It's much more than she bargained for. It's so warm, with a casual, elegant decor right out of the pages of a magazine. But the outward appearance alone isn't what grabs her. It's the aura of the home, which fills her with a comforting sense of joy as it envelops her with a wave of loving light. What a happy place, Kate exclaims with delight as she walks around the circles in the open room. Oh, it has a wonderful mana, Elaine says. Mana is a spiritual energy or a force that encompasses a person, place, or thing. Yes, it does, says Kate, a thrill running up and down her spine. Leave it to Elaine to summon precisely the right word to express the inexplicable way the cottage makes her feel. Upstairs, the lady chuckles and silently echoes the sentiment. A wonderful mana, indeed. So there you have. There is a spirit up there. And this spirit is one spirit. I'm not going to tell you who it is, because you'll find out when you read the book. But there's a few different spirits floating around that help their families and loved ones. And I'd like to open the floor up to questions, but I do want to say before I do that, that I've always wanted to write a book. And I've been very busy doing a lot of TV writing and producing movies and TV shows. And finally, I put myself on a schedule of setting out time every day to write. And I know that some of you here are writers, and who may be screenwriters or who want to write novels, and I welcome you to ask any questions you would like. So I can start off with one. I do have some people have written questions, so I'll start off with one and then I'll open it up to you guys. Oh, do you need to feel angst to write? No way. I need to feel complete peace and harmony. Actually, I'm no good if I'm worried about something. And when I write, I like to just make sure I usually write early in the morning for a few hours because everyone's sleeping and I love it. You know, it's quiet, my phone is quiet, no one's emailing me. Actually, I don't even check my emails. I make sure not to do that because then I will get caught up in answering them. I turn on music, maybe light a candle. And one of the things also that gives me a great peace is having an outline to write from. So before I write, I actually really work on the outline. It takes a number of months. And then I go back to it, I put it away, and I really make sure that it's a story that I want to tell, and it tells the theme that I really feel is a good way to tell the story. And then when I sit down, sometimes I can change it, like I did this book. I changed the setting a few times, and I changed some of the things that happened in the book. But when I do sit down, I like to just let it go, because I know where I'm going, and then when I'm sitting at the computer, and that scene comes to life in my mind, and I actually see it, and the characters start speaking. You think you may know what they're going to say, but all of a sudden words come into your head, and you're like, wow. Where did that come from? But you go with it. And you can always go back. But I think the main thing, too, is that you keep writing. You could always go back and edit. As long as you have an outline, you won't have to edit that much. You may want to add here and there. But that's why I feel it's really important to be secure in the outline. Let me take one other question. Oh, what is a synchronistic event? Okay, now in this book, there are a lot of synchronistic events. And if you've ever said to yourself, what a coincidence. Has anyone ever said that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's a synchronistic event. And it's a, Carl Jung coined it, and he was the first one to actually give it meaning. It's a series of events that are unrelated, yet they are related. They appear to be related, but they're not. And I'll give you an example. When I was writing this book, I actually went to the Big Island and of Hawaii, and I got up early one morning and I decided to go to the shops. I went to get a coffee, and I had made an appointment with a gentleman, Danny Akaka Jr., who is a Hawaiian cultural practitioner, and he actually did some Hawaiian translations on this book for me. And as I was walking along to the store, I see this group of people. Now, I went in a completely different way than I normally do, but I see this crowd of people around a front store. And I go, I'm curious. So I walked over and I see this gentleman in a Hawaiian garb blessing the store for opening. And I thought to myself, I wonder if that's Danny. And I turned to the person next to me and I said, who is that? Is it Danny Kaka? And they said, yes. So it was like, okay. And chills went up and down my spine and I'm like, this is crazy. Because I had never met him before. And I wasn't supposed to really go there that day, go that way. But yet, a series of events that are unrelated, but meaningfully related. So that's a synchronistic event. And there's a lot of them in this book that guide Kate. And so in the book, she has to learn how to read the signs. And the signs have been happening all along. And sometimes she might not have been aware, like we in real life, you know, we are not aware sometimes, but if we, again, keep ourselves calm, notice it, and then we go, oh wow, oh that makes sense, oh that's why that happened. And you might not know right away, but it's so awesome when it happens. And I now keep a diary of when they happen, because they can it can tell you things. You're, you know, when you meditate and when you are aware of the signs, it's just, it never ceases to amaze me. It excites me to no end. So do you have questions? Because I have more questions in here. I don't know if anyone has a particular question they want to ask.
So I actually read the book yesterday. Mm-hmm. And thank you. I enjoyed it. Uh-huh. And I sort of answered already, but is the book based on experiences that you've had or beliefs that you have about certain things? Is that taken from your life at all?
Or yes. The question is did I take from my own life,
yeah,
writing the book?
Beliefs.
And my beliefs. Yes, I did. And I'll tell you, another very funny, interesting, synchronistic event happened. When I was younger, I used to do creative writing. And I had written a few short stories. I completely forgot about them. And my mom kept little boxes of things for my brothers and sisters and I growing up. Little cards, anniversary cards to them. She kept short stories. And in one of these short stories, I wrote it when I was like 12 or 13, and it was about a girl, Jessica, who grew up in the Civil War, and in that story, her mother passes. And a neighbor says to her, don't worry, dear, you have to understand that our loved ones surround us and guide us, always. They're never far from us. And I read that as I was writing this book, and I thought, whoa, that's the theme of this book, pretty much. Here I was writing about it at 13, completely forgot about it. My brother gave me the stuff that was pulled from the attic. And I'm like, I actually started going through it and put it away. And then as I was reading this book, and so that went into the book. So there are things like that. And I think a writer, authors can't help but draw from their own experiences. And many do. And if you've seen any movies about, like they did a movie, I recently saw on Thomas More, where Jude Law played the lead character. And there was a movie about Jane Austen. Mm-hmm. I think it was Jane Austen. But it was interesting, because listening that they used certain experiences. So it's a fictional story, but you can't help but draw. And for me, the beliefs about loved ones living on, and also synchronistic events. And I have, my dreams have told me things, and it happens to Kate. So I used it, because it worked. It might not work for every story, but it worked for this one. Anything else?
Do you have any new projects?
A new projects? I do. I actually have a sequel to this book, and it's very different. In this book, which is about Kate, it's also about, as I mentioned, family, but one of her friends in the book, early on, invites her to a cottage in Kauai, and just kind of heal and relax and get tuned in. And so in this book, Kate is helped. In the next book, she helps her friends. And so it goes on beyond that, because I think there's other books that will come out of that series. But so I'm doing that, and this also has a script. I did write a script, so I'm pitching that with my representatives. And I just want to do more books and screenplays.
I have one more question.
Okay.
Are there recipes in any of these?
Yes.
Good.
Now, I don't give you the exact ingredients. The question was asked, are there recipes in this? Now, if people know me, they know that I have a blog, Simply Delicious Living, and it's a show on TV. And I love cooking. And Kate, loves to cook. And she also likes to take photos. Okay, well, I do for my own life. But what I do mention recipes, and there's a place in here, a fictitious cafe, the Plumeria Cafe, and I do go into, because Kate cooks for Olivia and makes some dishes, and those dishes are on my blog. Couldn't help it, sorry.
I'm glad.
When you do your outline for the book, do you actually, I know some of the mechanics, but do you do a chapter one, chapter two, do you categorize them that way?
Do I do an outline for the book?
Yeah, by chapter?
I do. I actually, in writing screenplays, I use a 7-act system, and I bullet out each scene, that in every scene in the act.
Right.
And that's actually helped me write my novel. And I'll tell you why, because I think I always wanted to write a novel, but I had to put myself on a schedule, and I thought, well, how am I going to start? You know, I read a few books, and I'm like, this is not helping. What other people, their methods. I guess everyone has to find their own method. Well, my method is I need a map, because I can have fun in between, but if I don't know where I'm going, forget it. I don't want to sit down to a blank page and go, ah. And I also don't want to go back and edit too much. I rather do all the prep work, and if it's a mystery like this, has mystical elements, I have to plant clues. So how am I going to start writing just, you know, stream of consciousness? And I may need a clue in chapter 10, you know, that something can be solved in chapter 20, and that relates to chapter 1. So I have to know what I'm doing. And so a map is really important, but I use the outline for writing a screenplay. And then you have to kind of get into a flow of a book, because it's a lot different than a screenplay. But that's how I started. And it was also great because it gave me my screenplay. I knew where I was going to go when I wrote my screenplay, because I actually bulleted it out like a screenplay. And then I changed it around, because when you write a novel, you have to get into the scene, the feeling, what you're seeing, you know, what the characters feel and see. Where when you write a screenplay, it may be, you know, some direction, like Johnny walks in and shuts the door and sits down at the table. And then says, hi, Joan. And in a novel, it could be, it's a windy day, you know, and the lightning is about to strike, and, you know, Jenny is shivering as she makes her cup of coffee, you know, something like that. And it's a lot more descriptive, and you can see it, because you have to see it. And when I write, whether it be a screenplay or a novel or whatever I write, I always see it as a movie. Because I'm a very visual person, and I think it helps me write it and feel it. And because you're also doing everything. When you're a writer, a screenplay writer, you're writing. There is a director, there are actors, you know, there's set designer and everything. But when you're writing a book, you are all those people. So I do, that's what I do, like about it. Because it doesn't take a village, like making a movie. So,
And when you're writing a play, it's a third discipline.
Absolutely.
I have a background in that.
Playwriting?
Yeah, so then you're looking at people taking your words and actually...
Right. You're a play, because you have actors on a stage that have to say your words. But anything you do, I think, even... I don't know any person who does writing plays that doesn't know what's going to happen.
Right.
You know, you have to plan it out.
You still have to be beginning, middle, and end.
Yeah. And then with a novel, there's so much that goes in between. And I think one of the ladies before asked me, what was your question about, you? Someone wanted you to change a character? So a lady was writing a screenplay, right?
I spent 2 years writing a screenplay, and I sent it out to a professional reader. And 2 days before, at the beginning, I had a bolt of lightning changing a young man into a fox, right? And I thought, that doesn't make sense. Lightning's not going to do that. So I made it a witch, you know? And then he said that my entire screenplay is about this witch character, and I need to develop a witch and all that. And
so, you know, when something like that happens, when someone tells you to change something, they often do. And you have to really know in yourself, is this the story, who the characters are? Sometimes you can take, like an editor, when you're doing a book, they may say to you, add a little bit more there. I think it might be a good idea. And you can do that if you agree. And when you're writing a screenplay, but you have to really have confidence in your story, because you are telling the story, and you have to make it be true to you. And you have to have passion for it, because it takes so much discipline and effort that if you don't have passion for it, and it's not really coming from your heart, the words aren't going to come out. And the feeling that people reading it are not thinking that right. And I even read something where, actually there's a restaurant called Inn of the Seventh Ray, and I was eating there one time. It's in Topanga Canyon, a beautiful little restaurant by a creek. And the owner said, I don't let my chefs cook unless they're happy. Oh. And I think they even made a movie, Water for Chocolate, about that. And it's same with writing. If you're not feeling it, if you're not happy and joyous, like for this book, I had to be joyous, you know, and even though there's sad moments and whatever, you have to feel something. There's almost like an energy that takes it over. And if you're not in the right energy, it's not going to come out right. The characters aren't going to move people, or the story won't have meaning. And so you have to have some, that's why the outline is so important. Because if you really go over your outline and there's something saying, I don't know, or you just say, I'm tired, I'm just going to put that in there. You can't do that. It has to really make sense. And the outline, that's why it takes sometimes doing it, putting it away, coming back to it. And even when you write a novel, when you finish it, you put it away for a little bit, you go back to it, and you have to edit it. You'll find a little word here and there. You may find, oh, why did I say that? You know, and you say it another way, and that can go on and on. There comes a point where you have to say, stop it. Usually it's your editor that says, stop it. You know, but you always find things that you want to tweak, and then finally you do get to that point. But you have to go come back, but you're not making major changes when you do that. It's just little things here and there.
Great.
Margie?
You mentioned you do so many things in different areas of, like, the movie that you did and the books that you write, and you mentioned that you do a blog on your cooking.
Mm-hmm.
Do you do a blog on your overall, like, you mentioned you speak at book clubs, and do you do a blog on where you're going to be and what other things you're doing besides the cooking?
Oh.
I'm not a cook.
Okay.
So
the question was, I have a cooking blog, simplydeliciousliving.com. Do I have a place on that where it tells other things that I'm doing?
Your schedule and
my schedule. Yes. It's MaryannRidiniSpencer.com. My name will have that on there. And my blog has it. Everything's accessible through my website. And if you go on there, it'll have events or upcoming events. And it will tell you where I'm speaking. And for the book club that we have, you asked about, or you mentioned the book club. There are many people that have book clubs all over the country. So if I'm in a city, I will do a book club in person or a speaking engagement. But if I'm not, sometimes I can do it by Skype or I'll do a phone call. But I'll be doing a number of them. And so if anyone has a book club they want, just contact me through my website. And we can schedule. As long as I can schedule it in advance, I can do that. But yeah, so it has to be very organized.
What do you find more enjoyable, writing novels or screenplays?
I know
different disciplines.
Yeah, they're very different. Yeah. What do I like better, writing screenplays or novels?
Just personally, like.
I love them both. I really do. I've written original screenplays and I've adapted screenplays. Sometimes when you're adapting from a novel, other people's novels, not my novel, it's easier, but when I'm working with another person's novel, you really want to be true to what the author wanted to convey, and you don't want to change it so much, but you also have to make sure it translates into a film. Many books, the way they are, will not translate, and I've worked with some novelists, they don't really understand it, and they kind of, you know, get a little bit, why did you have to add that, or what are you doing? You know, I said, because you can't live in your head in a movie. It's a visual thing. And you have to tell the story in an hour and a half or two, you know, and 124 pages, 125 pages if it's a screenplay. So, you know, I love doing that because it's a challenge. But I don't know, but I love writing novels right now. But if someone said, you know, do you want to write a screenplay? I'd say, sure. And I probably will write screenplays of all my novels.
I mean, I could readily see that as a film. So,
oh, thank you.
So quickly, I mean.
Thank you. I actually, a few people have said, this is a film. And I said, thank you.
When you're reading it, I thought.
Go ahead, sir.
Have you found much in the desert that appears? Do you have a relationship with the desert?
I do. We actually have a home here. And I am down here quite a bit. And I also was a writer for Palm Springs Life. I did lifestyle and food, big surprise. And I did a lot, some writing for Desert Sun. For I think I worked with Palm Springs Light for almost 7 years. As a contributing writer, editor. So I love it here. I absolutely love it here. Anybody else? I can take one more. I don't know if you guys are getting tired yet.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, this is one. Very interesting. I'm writing a book. How do I tell when I'm finished? Your outline will tell you. But I'll tell you how I knew with this. Because as I was writing, even though I was following the outline, I could have probably written a little more at the end, but I'm like, no. No, it doesn't. I don't need to. The climax happened. What, you know, I don't want to tell you because I want you to. But afterwards, the dust settled and certain things happened. And it was just the way it ends is meaningful to the story. So while I could have written more, it was like, I don't need it. It's excess. So I think knowing how to write in a way that, like in a movie, if you saw a movie, and I'm sure many of you have seen movies, it's a natural ending. Mm-hmm. And you go, what do? They just add another 20 minutes. They could have cut it.
Right.
Well, you don't want that. You want to end on something that's going to grab somebody.
When you do an outline, the physicality of it, do you put it up on the wall? Or
when I do an outline, do I put it up on the wall?
For this novel, for example.
No. I start, sometimes I'll type it because I can't read my handwriting. But with this one, I actually had a yellow line piece of paper, mm-hmm. and I had my screenplay format, and then I just started scribbling. And it was like late one night, or you know, you could do it during the day, and I put it down, I went back to it. Once I thought I had something that I might want to work with, then I went to my computer and typed it out. But normally I do type it out because, I can't read my handwriting. But I think, especially a novel, and I did it with screenplays too, I use yellow line paper first, but I always put it in that format.
Some people use postcards and they
postcards?
Move them around, but that's...
No, if I use postcards, I'd be like, where's that other postcard? I'd lose it.
Yeah.
I can't do that.
Yeah.
No. Unless I misunderstood, you said something about a 7-act system.
Mm-hmm.
So in screenplays, you're usually talking about 3, so where's your 7-act?
No, not necessarily.
No.
Okay. Not the way I learned. And I can share that with you. I don't have it, but I can show you the outline. And it's certain number, I think the first act is like 13 scenes, and then you go, it's scene by scene. And then it builds. You know, there's a certain amount, the introduction is in the first act. The 3 acts are plays, really. But what I'm talking about is what you use when you write a screenplay for a movie. So I use that format for 125-page format. That's what I use. Now, other people may think, what are you doing? How can you use a screenplay format? Well, it works for me.
It's a good outline.
You know, again, whatever works for you. And I think it was, for me, it was getting over that hump of saying, how am I going to write a book? 400 pages, and I had to break it down because it was too overwhelming to even approach. And then once I did that, I'm like, what was I thinking? I wasn't, you know, and so I was able to do the second book, and now I'm working on the third book. You know, I needed to make it feel comfortable. So whatever that is for you to feel a comfort level, but a lot of people they stop themselves. Or they say, oh, okay, I would want to do it, but they never do it because it's like, how can you? You know, they think they have to write the whole thing in a week or something. And you don't want to do that. And actually, with my 20 pages a week, that's for me. Some other people may say 10. But I wanted to get it done in a certain time frame. And I felt, because I know how I write, and I'm a fast writer, I am, once I have an outline, I said, you know, I have to do other stuff during the day. I don't have the luxury of just sitting down for 8 hours a day, or 10, or whatever, writing. I have to do other work. I'm a journalist, and I have to, you know, there's other things that I have to do, other commitments. So 20 pages comes out of 2 hours a day, or some days I get 3, or whatever. If I can do that 20 pages in 3 days, I take the rest of the time off. I don't try to force myself to write, because the second I feel like tired, not good stuff comes out. So I just say, okay, enough, I'll go back to it. And then you have to feel like you really want to do it.
So when you did The Lost Valentine, you wrote it first as a screenplay or a book, and how long did it take you before someone bought it and made it into a movie?
Well, The Lost Valentine was originally The Last Valentine by James Michael Pratt. And a friend of mine knew that I was producing movies for Showtime and Sci-Fi Network, and I was doing a lot of producing and packaging, but not writing. She knew that I wanted to write a screenplay, and she said, you know, you should look at this book, it's a nice story. And she said, I know that the author wants it to be made into a movie. So I read it, and I loved it. And I said, you know, there is no development money. So I like it enough where I did my deal so I could write the screenplay and get his permission to do that. And so after I wrote it, I thought, where can I take this? And we were lucky. We took it to one place, although originally they said no. It was Hallmark Hall of Fame. They passed. And I'm like, okay, where do we go now? And it just kind of sat there. I worked on other projects. A year later, I was watching the Today Show, and Jeff Bridges and his brother and mother were on. She had written, I think, a book about Valentine's Day, or the father had passed, Lloyd Bridges. And it clicked in my mind. I'm like, I got to go back to Hallmark. I mean, Lost Valentine, Hallmark, Valentine's Day, cards. They have to do it. So I talked with the people I was working with in association, the production companies, we pitched it again, and Hallmark said yes. And then after they said yes, we did our deal in 2006, but they had other productions scheduled. So we didn't actually start filming until 2010. But I know is, it doesn't always sometimes take that long, but I have news for you. I've been told there's a statistic. Getting a project mounted from the screenplay to the film in Hollywood sometimes takes 13 years. That's the average. So you have to have a lot of things in the works because you don't want to wait around, you know, and so it's important. And that's why I do a lot of different writing. Like sometimes people say, why are you doing novels? You do screenplays, don't you? Or why are you doing screenplays? Aren't you a journalist? You have to do everything. And you do things that you have passion for and that you like. And I decided a long time ago, after producing other people's movies, and it takes a lot, and it's not always fun, and there's a lot of personalities, and I thought to myself, why am I spending so much time producing other people's movies that other people are writing, and I'm like going crazy trying to get the finance, and I gotta write my own stuff. And so I made a commitment only to write and produce my own things, because it takes so much time and effort and money. And I'm like, there's only, you know, if I live to be 500, yeah, maybe I could. But you know, there's limited time, even if I want to write till I'm 100 or 20 or so.
You had a great actress in that movie. Was it Vanessa Redgrave?
We had Betty White.
Betty White, okay.
And Jennifer Love Hewitt.
Right.
And they were wonderful. I have to say that Darnell Martin, who directed The Lost Valentine, did such a beautiful job. And one of the scary parts sometimes turning over what you do to other people. I was nervous a little, thinking, oh gosh, I hope it looks okay. You know, I don't know. But when I saw that first cut, I'm like, oh. It was like beautiful. I was so happy. I'm like, boy, I was so excited. I was excited when I heard Betty said yes. But when I saw the first cut, but you know, the director's cut, and then they had to do a lot of editing after, but I just knew. I was really pleased, because it's like a baby. You want someone to take good care of your baby. They don't always do. You know, I've seen other projects that I've worked on, other things, or people may get an idea in their head, and they just sometimes, I think, ruin it. So you want to make sure your baby's well protected. Any other questions? Should I take one more?
Sure.
Are you tired? Let's see, what is this? Do you have a routine? I think I kind of went over that. I get up in the morning. I usually exercise, eat breakfast at my computer while I'm writing for the first few hours, and then I start my other day. And then, of course, I have to quit by a certain time and my husband gets upset because I have to be there for the family. And I think balance is really important because you can go crazy writing. I mean, you could be writing morning, noon, and night. And I don't want, I want a balanced life. You know, I want to be able to enjoy life because that's part of being able to write, to experience things, to write about things from the heart. And I think you need to have the balance in order to do that. And that goes back to earlier on, you know, that question about do I write with angst? Not a good thing. Not for me anyway. Some people it may work for, but I don't know if they live long.
Yeah, we can't
do
that.
Hi there. How are you?
Good to see you.
Any other questions or anything?
No, it's interesting.
Do you want another question or are you ready?
I would.
Okay. I will talk until you say, get out of here, until John gets the cane. No, the lay.
That's right. That's right.
No, I did that one already. Let's see. What inspires you? Art, nature, absolutely. Music, other people's work. I mean, if you're going to be a writer, you need to read. I've read so many scripts because before I started writing them, I worked for the studios. I was a vice president at the Candle Studios, and I used to have to read a lot of scripts. And then when I was producing movies for different networks, I had to read a lot of feature film scripts and movie scripts. So that also, when you're reading so many scripts, you kind of get to understand the flow and what works and what doesn't. And I also love novels, so I think read as much as you can. And read the kind of work that you want to write. Like, if you want to write mysteries, know who they are. Know who those mystery writers are. And that really, I think, is just so important. But finding out, like, sometimes it could be a painting that inspires you, or a place. Like, for me, it was Kauai. And when I went there, even though I thought I was going to place the book somewhere in Kutchog, which I still love that town, and maybe that's another book, but what I loved about Kauai also is that aloha spirit, because aloha is the way you must, if you know Hawaii, they live the spirit of aloha. It's actually incorporated into their law, the aloha spirit state law. And it's treating other people with kindness, respect, integrity, recognizing the God in other people, and then also taking care of our planet. And when you do that, it uplifts the spirit or the mana, which is spirit in Hawaiian, of the whole planet, because we're all connected. And I just thought, I need to be there with this book, because it's not a spooky story. Even though it's about spirits and ghosts a little bit, it's not spooky. Not spooky is traditionally spooky. It's still kind of, it's mystical, but it's not going to scare you, I hope. I didn't mean to scare anybody, but it has that element. So,
not a Stephen King novel.
It's not a Stephen King novel. Anybody else? Any other questions? Should I take one more or no? Are we done?
Whenever you want to be.
Guys,
great group, you guys.
One last one. Okay. I'm on a roll. Let's see. Did that. Okay, one last. Uh-oh. What keeps you motivated? And how do you get your creative juices back if you lose them? I think, again, it comes back to balance. And motivation, just don't sit down if it's forced. Don't sit down at your computer. Do anything else. Go shopping. Do whatever will relax you or get you inspired. If you need some inspiration, go to an exhibit. Do what you like. If it's golfing, golf. It's going to an art show, go to an art show. Dancing, dancing. But I don't think it's a good idea to sit down when you really don't want to be there. But you do have to have the discipline to sit down. So if you say, okay, 2 hours a day, 2 hours a day goes by fast. And if you have an outline, you will be inspired. And if you're not inspired by your outline, edit and get another outline. Because that will inspire you and keep you on track. And if you're not inspired to sit there, something's wrong, you know, and then you have to redo it until you are inspired to sit there. And again, small steps. And it doesn't have to be every day. But if you have like 20 pages a week, for me, it could be 10 pages. Some people, it might be 5. But just do that, and over time, you will achieve it. Mm-hmm.
I have about a third of a novel there.
Mm-hmm.
I put it away because I things have happened. But can you go back and start your outline, even though
yes.
you have a third of the novel?
Absolutely. The question was, if you started a novel, you're a third of the way through, can you go back? I started writing this book. It's another book. I mean, I have like 4 or 5 chapters that takes place during World War II in France. And I'm like, whoa, okay, good book, but not this one. And I changed this several times now. I may go back to that story at some point. Because I really do like those chapters. But it's like, it's not really what I wanted for this book, for that theme. So yeah, you can always go back and change it.
I mean, just outline it.
Yes.
Outline what's already there.
No, I think if you go, you can, if you like what you have, you can go back and change the outline. And even if you like some of your chapter, like chapter 1 and 2 or something, you can go back and rewrite it. But the thing is to stay motivated to write it. So that begins with the outline. Because you don't want to keep changing your outline all the time while you're writing. You kind of want to follow that blueprint and keep yourself motivated.
Do you have a rule on how long each chapter is when you write?
How long each chapter? No. Now, it can be, you know, a few pages. It can be 10 pages. There might be a rule of thumb, but I think you have to go with your gut. Because sometimes, you know, you could just write on or follow a rule. But you don't really want to follow a rule because it's not going to be true, and it's like you don't need to. And within a chapter, you can. What I do sometimes, I think even in this book, they put the little butterfly things. Where is it? Give you a good example. It kind of breaks it up like a scene. Here's an example. So the chapter started, and then there's a little butterfly. Something different happens, but it's part of that chapter. So it's like you can like have little scenes in a chapter. No, actually, I wrote that way. They wanted to put though a little something kind of a little green thing. And I said, let's put a butterfly because the butterfly, as you notice, is on the cover.
It's a great cover.
That's a symbol of a spirit, and I didn't know that until I Googled it. And I realized after looking that many cultures for many centuries consider butterfly a spiritual symbol. So that's why I did it. And that when they had a little flower in there, and I said, can we make it a butterfly? It's something different. But they did choose the type of butterfly. And they told me that this is from Hawaii, even though it's the Gulf something.
Fritillary?
Yes, Gulf Fritillary. It's from the Gulf, but they are very popular in Hawaii. And so I said, okay, works for me. Yeah.
My background is Lepidoptera, so
it's
just butterflies and moth.
See, you know, absolutely.
I was checking that out. Okay.
So there is a story to probably everything. I did have them put these little things, though, to make it like, you know, little
brightness.
Spirits there, whatever.
Fun.
Anything else? And you know, this cover is a like, it wasn't necessarily going to be this cover. I had some other ideas that I talked with the publisher about. But they had to do a presentation, I guess, to the sales staff or Barnes & Noble staff. And they came up with this cover, and they liked it, and it got well received. And so I said, sure. And I loved it. I thought the colors were beautiful and everything, but
so
you know, it's funny how things happen.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Are you working on a screenplay, or are you going to write another novel?
I finished the screenplay.
Oh, you finished it. But you wrote that first.
After I wrote this, I was compelled immediately to write the screenplay.
Got it.
Because I had a dream about the star, of who was going to star in the screenplay. And I said, okay, that will remain until the movie gets made. But I said, I have got to write the screenplay now while it's fresh. And I have written the second book, which I'm editing.
What I loved about the cover is when you think about the lady in the window, you imagine something dark and dreary, and the cover is just the complete opposite. So it gets your attention.
Well, that's why, you know, lady in the window, spirits, could be a spooky thing.
Yeah.
I didn't want it to be. because it's not spooky. It's about love and family and spirit and all our connectedness to one another.
Yeah.
And it's anything but spooky. Although some people believe in spirit, some don't, but it is what it is. I'm sure people can relate to things that happen to her. Because I think we've all had experiences that we can't explain. And we all have intuition, whether we realize it or not. And we all can develop our intuition, whether we realize it or not. But if you follow certain signs and you meditate, you do certain things, you get answers. And we all get it. We all have that ability. It's not... some people may do it more than others because they may practice and study it. But I think we all can tune into what works for us. And in this book, she had to find out what works for her. Because her life was going along, and then a lot of things happened that weren't good. So it's like, what do you do when tragedy strikes? What do you do if you lose a relationship or a job or whatever? How do you heal? And so I also wanted to give practical examples of what I think, what I've done in my life, but also what I feel that I've learned, what people do to help heal, you know, the loss of something. Because we're all going to go through it at one time or another. And in her case, something big happens, or someone she loves deeply. So you have, and it affects you. It can't help but affect you. And your life changes. And that's what happened to her.
Is your next book spiritual along that line?
But of course.
So you're
it's
into
a
that,
sequel.
You're into that
is my next book along the lines of that spiritual? It has to be. Because it's the same. Is similar characters with new ones introduced?
So we're looking at 13 years before your screenplay.
No.
No.
That's the exception. No 13 years on this screenplay.
Where would
Marvel, to God's ears, please, next year. Thank you. I'll wait till next year. Sooner the better. If it happens, fine. But no, I don't want to wait 13 years.
Are you writing your screenplay for Hallmark type station? Or
I actually, I did the screenplay thinking of it as a feature film.
Okay.
And I'll tell you why. Because of the setting. I need, in this, the setting of Hawaii, the botanical gardens, the coast, the marine life.
No.
There's a scene I say, underwater where they're swimming and you see the fish and things like that. You have to experience it. And I love television, but I don't think it's going to make the same impact because you have to be in this film to really get it. And I think when you're immersed in a huge screen with the visuals and the sound effects of the, you know, water, you can feel the mantra. I think it's important to feel the mantra with all the people that go to see it. You know what I'm saying? It's like, it has to. For me, it's big screen. I really would not want to see it on a small screen. Anybody else? Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Mahalo.
Thank you.